Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Simon Anthony Aboufadel. I run the SAG Foundation Life Raft program. My promise to you is if you say my name and title three times, you'll be vocally warmed up for any audition for a David Milch production. We'd like to welcome our online audience. Thank you for your patience. Sometimes these logistics of this live stream and what's going on in-house causes us to run just a little bit late. So we thank you so much for your patience. Without further ado, I just want to do a quick disclaimer and just let you know that anything mentioned tonight isn't necessarily the view of the Screen Actors Guild or the Screen Actors Guild Foundation. So just make up your own mind on anything you hear tonight or seek your own counsel. And other than that, we are very excited to have an incredible legend with us tonight that I'm going to let our moderator introduce, Michael. Michael D. Cohen is our moderator tonight. Michael has been doing the auditions programs, evening with casting directors with us, and he's helped us with a future producer panel. Michael is an actor, writer, acting coach. He's recently been nominated for a Gemini Award. That's a Canadian Emmy. And a, we have Canadians. and a Canadian Comedy Award, and has been cast as the lead in upcoming feature film It Was You by director Emmanuel Chirian. He teaches acting and voiceover privately and at the SAG Conservatory, and has moderated casting panels and lectured on Shirtlift's guideposts here at the SAG Foundation Life Raft program. Please do welcome Michael D. Cohen.
Hello. This is very exciting. I'm absolutely thrilled to be here and to introduce David Milch. He is one of the most accomplished and acclaimed writer, producer, creators of television that we have today. He's created NYPD Blue, Deadwood, John from Cincinnati, and he's currently working on a project called Luck, another series he's created for HBO that stars Dustin Hoffman. So please welcome David Milch.
I bring with me one of the accumulating indignities of age.
Or a lot of sitting as a writer, right? So, first off, thanks so much for making the time to be with us tonight.
Happy to do it.
And are you working on Luck now? Is that actually in production?
We finished a couple of weeks ago. That's being post-produced, being edited. And right at the moment, I'm working on a movie called Heavy Rain for Warner Brothers, which is an adaptation of a computer game. Has anyone played it? Well, you're ahead of me. and I must say that I am a Luddite as pertains to all of the mod cons. And by mod cons, I'm going back to cell phones. I don't have a cell phone. I don't know how to use a computer. So I approach projects from the other media with a certain amount of trepidation, but it's not so bad. You push all the buttons and ask me a question.
Okay, I was just well, when you said you don't know how to use a computer, I was thinking, are you writing longhand when you're doing scripts? I mean, seriously?
I dictate.
Oh.
And I lie on the floor, and there's a gentleman who is behind the computer, and as I dictate, the words appear, and then I tell him to fix things, and they get fixed.
Sounds a little psychoanalytic in a way.
It would be if I had a brain in my head.
I somehow think you do. So you seriously lie on the floor and you have an assistant?
Yeah, I've got a bad back, as you can tell. And I've been doing it that way for, I guess, 20 years.
Wow. And have you been working with the same person? Or is this like an assistant?
No, they wear out and we toss them.
Right. I can just imagine what an amazing...
Can't be sentimental in this racket.
What an amazing experience it must be for that person to just sort of witness your creative process.
Actually, a great many of those people are writers now and working in the business. I also have interns who are in the room with me. I always try and have 5 interns or so. I try to explain my process, what's going on as I write, and it's a way of kind of trying to stay present to the possibilities of the teaching moment as well as the creative moment.
So you are genuinely multitasking when you're writing. I mean, that's a lot.
Yeah.
It's juggling.
And not only that, but you try and keep all your resentments alive at the same time. Kind of goes without saying.
So by the time you get on the floor, let's talk about what happens before that.
It's never pretty getting down.
I mean, at what point do you actually do that? How much preparation, where are your ideas at by the time you're ready to do that?
You know, this is going to sound very strange, but if it doesn't, then the crowd is a little strange.
That's possible.
I don't think about what I'm going to write before I start to write. And I pray, and I ask to be willing, and then I see what happens.
Can you tell me a little bit more what you mean by you pray?
There's a prayer which some people in this room may be familiar with. I offer myself to thee, to build with me and do with me as thou wilt. Relieve me of the bondage of self, that I may better do thy will. And goes on like that. And it's just to ask, it's just an asking to have the perspective of self lifted and to be able to give myself to the situation of the characters.
I've heard you talk a bit about the role of the ego in getting in the way of creativity. I mean, that's essentially what you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
And is that something that came to you with practice, or is this something? I mean,
very much so. Yeah. I am afflicted, blessed, challenged, however you want to describe it, with I'm nuts. I have all sorts of kind of obsessive compulsive impulses and traits, you know, where the type of person where you feel you have to touch your knee in multiples of 4 before, of course, then you have to touch your nose multiples of 6 and like that. And it can get to be a busy day. So the prayer that I say is a sort of asking to be submitted to a different state of spirit and being when I'm working.
So I've noticed, you know.
I only hope that something is ringing, because otherwise I'm having a stroke.
I don't hear anything. No. I don't, nothing. in the shows that you've created, I mean, John, I guess John from Cincinnati is one of the most blatant examples of how spirituality comes in. Mm-hmm. But it seems to be a theme for you. How did that evolve?
That's what it did. It evolved. The first show I worked on was called Hill Street Blues, which, thank you very much. And that was 30 years ago. 30 years ago. It was very rigorous it was called a procedural. The idea about the public's taste was that an audience kind of wanted to know exactly what it was going to experience each hour of the program. And that there was a certain amount of latitude allowed within that expectation, but there was going to be a main crime and there was going to be a secondary crime and like that. And there are still people who make a pretty good living at that. One of them, I'll talk out of school. I was working with this one gentleman who continues to do very well, and invariably the stories that he would pitch, we would get to a certain point, and the turning point always wound up contingent upon it turning out that the protagonists were twins. Or in moments of high imaginative dungeon that they had known each other in Vietnam. And there was a grudge that was being settled somehow. And over the course of time, and it was a blessing to me to have been allowed to do any kind of work, but to work on that show in particular, because I was so wacky that in the absence of that kind of rigid format, you know, when I would begin to work, I mean, it was even money or less, I'd wind up in the same town by the end of the day, let alone have accomplished anything, you know. So being able to work within that kind of format was a stabilizing influence. And then over the course of time, as I gained a better access to my gift and was able to work with a greater latitude in terms of the expectation of the story and the character, then things loosened up a little. But there was a time there, I remember, when I first got that job, when I got my first job, they were paying me for a month's work every week, as I thought. I was getting this check, and I'm thinking, these idiots, you know. And obviously, I'm not going to tell anybody, you know, about what was going on. But with all this loot, every night I would fly to Las Vegas. Wow. And I would gamble all night. And then I would come back at 6:30 in the morning, and I would wait for the studio to open up. And then I would write and repeat that process, except for the weekends when I would stay in Las Vegas the whole weekend. And after about 3 months, as it became clear that I was hanging on, you know, I was lucky enough, actually, the first script I wrote, it won the Emmy and a bunch of other things. And I finally turned myself in, you know, and I said, I got it. You know, you've been paying me 4 times. And they said, no, that's your
paycheck.
That's your salary. You know. So after I had gotten off my knees in the aftermath of that, gradually I started to normalize my existence. But it was not an uneventful journey. You know?
You had some bumps along the way.
A few bumps along the way.
So in terms of the tie to your spirituality, did that also evolve over time as you...
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. I would think you know, one of the deepest convictions that a person like myself walks around with is the sense of being an imposter, that you're fooling them, you know. And one of the corollary propositions is today the day they find out, you know. The gift that comes to one, over the course of time, if you're lucky enough to have enough time given to you, is to except that all you need to do is channel that imposterhood and you're writing stories. And that requires simply a degree of self-acceptance, which doesn't entail the belief that you don't deserve, that you have to fool them in order to stick around. And once you've accepted that, you know, you walk upright just like everybody else, and can I think that so much of accomplishment in art comes not from the discovery of one's gift, but from its acceptance. Maybe as the evening goes on, we can talk some more about that in the context of your own experiences. And
well, like the ego has a flip side. It can make us think that we're bigger than we are or smaller than we are, in a sense.
Every so often, it can let us be right-sized.
Yeah. That's brilliant. I mean, I've heard you say some things in interviews that just absolutely blew my mind. And I'm just curious about
like
how...
I'll pay you on Thursday.
Yeah. Exactly, because that doesn't happen. You have this quote about reality. Reality is a lie agreed upon. I mean, yeah. How do you? I mean, that's so interesting for a writer to say, because you're creating fiction in a sense, and you have, especially in Deadwood, used reality. I mean, you've used factual. You looked at the actual diaries of the people from Deadwood to create that series.
Sure. Currency is what I was talking about. I think specifically in that connection, and
the reality quote, you mean? Or?
Yeah, you know, money, currency, is simply a piece of paper, and it is an illusion agreed upon to the extent that you and I agree that it has a certain worth, and behave accordingly. It generates, as a result of the expenditure of our energy and imaginative effort, it generates a reality. But it has no intrinsic reality. And so more generally, not just speaking about currency, but reality itself is simply the behavior produced by the agreement among souls to behave in a certain fashion according to certain stimuli. That, I'll take a couple of minutes of your time to say that once you have sort of identified and come to believe in the truth of that a symbol is simply an illusion agreed upon. When I went in to pitch Deadwood, I had developed a series about and you'll be able to see the parallel almost immediately, about city cops in Rome at the time of Nero. What that has to do with a Western set in the Dakota Territory is a little problematic, so I got through this elaborate pitch, and the first guy that you see the city cops arrest is St. Paul, who is proselytizing against the wishes of the emperor. And I go through this whole thing, and they're getting, I can see I got them. So I'm done, you know, I say, well, what do you think? We love it, but we just bought a show set in Rome. So they said it reminds me that there's some ostentatious Jewish people and their son's about to get bar mitzvah, and they decide that they want to have their kid bar mitzvah where no Jewish kid has ever been bar mitzvah, so they arrange to go to Kenya.
That's where I had my bar mitzvah.
And they they hire a dozen elephants, you know, and they're going out into the jungle for, they have a rabbi out there for the ceremony, and they, and all of a sudden the procession comes to a pause, and the father of the lucky boy asks the guy, he says, what's the problem, what's the holdup? And the guy says, there's another bar mitzvah ahead of us. So that's how I felt in the pitch. You know, I worked out this tremendous thing set in Rome and the genesis of faith, and it turned out there was another bar mitzvah ahead of me. So, but they said, well, can you sort of turn that around and put it in another setting? And I said immediately, sure, we can make it a Western. And the truth is that what I had been interested in, what in the series about Rome, was how Paul's coming to proselytize had offered a different symbol upon which people could organize, around which people could organize. The symbol had been the emperor, and Paul was now proffering the cross. And to the extent that was the case, the idea of setting a show in the Black Hills, where gold had just been discovered, and the agreement to act, the agreement among white people to act as if gold had a particular value, and to organize their behavior around that collective agreement, was really the same story. And I believe that the blessing of art is the, there's a fancy term called metempsychosis, which is the transmigration of spirits. And I believe that if one comes in prayer and an open heart to the possibilities of the day, and the possibilities of that day include someone saying there's a bar mitzvah ahead of you, you may be willing to say, okay, we'll make it a Western. There's some kernel of truth in there. I'm not exactly sure.
Well, did that just come to you in the meeting when you were pitching, or did you have this? You just, out it came. Oh, it'll be Western. Wow. So
there was a chemist, Kekulé, who had spent 20 years studying the structure of the benzene ring, and he woke up one morning, and he had a dream of a snake swallowing its tail, and that was the structure of the benzene ring. And someone said to him, not bad, go to sleep, wake up, you got the structure of the benzene ring. And he said, visions come to prepared spirits. Mm. And my feeling was that all the years of prayer, of asking to be willing, I offer myself to thee to build with me and do with me as thou wilt. Relieve me of the bondage of self, that I may better do thy will. That turned out to be his will in that room at that time.
That's amazing. A lot of the characters, the specificity with which you write is, I think, one of the many elements that make it so acclaimed, so rich, so textured. And it comes across that you're just not scared to go anywhere. You'll go to the dark places.
Yeah, well, I don't realize they're dark. I believe, you know, if God is anywhere, he's everywhere. And I try to act in faith that that's the case, so that even what sounds like, I remember I was working in Deadwood, forgive me, this story gets a little racy, but the seeming villain, the protagonist, as I believe, of the story is a guy named Swearingen, who is a whore master and very violent, and he runs the bar there, and there's an episode, and I'm writing this episode, and I decided as in among the accumulating indignities of age, Swearingen has become impotent, as is the wont of males in a situation like that, he's blaming the girl. He has this prostitute who's been servicing him, and he says, "That's pretty obvious you're doing something different because I don't have a problem." He says, you're positioning your mouth differently, you're doing something different with your, something is different. And she takes the blame upon herself, and he's getting drunker and drunker, and he had, a couple of weeks before, a boss had come into town, based on a real character. Many of you, I'm sure, have seen the movie Citizen Kane. So Citizen Kane was based on William Randolph Hearst, who was a big media baron. And the father of William Randolph Hearst in real life was a guy named George Hearst. And the base of George Hearst's fortune was a big gold claim in the Black Hills. And I wrote the character of George Hearst as the antagonist of Swearingen, who Hearst is coming in and is trying to organize the mining of gold in a way that makes more efficient the manipulation of the symbol in order to get people to behave the way you want them to behave, with wage laborers and so on. Anyway, Swearingen is putting up a beef about this because he wants people to behave the way he wants them to behave in his joint. And Hearst takes an axe, and he has one of his henchmen chop off Swearingen's fingers to let him know that things are about to get serious. And it's in the aftermath of losing his middle finger that Swearingen becomes impotent. And Freudians among us will suggest that it's a dislocation of a castration fantasy that he's experiencing. But he's telling a story to this prostitute, and he's remembering how his mother had given him away when he was 6 years old. The first gold rush in America, surprisingly enough, was in Georgia. And she was living in New Orleans, and she heard about this gold rush, and she went to get on a boat to service the miners there. And the inconvenience was she had this son. So she took all the money that she had, and she went to an orphanage, and she knocked on the door of the orphanage. And when the minister opened the door, she shoved all the money that she had in his hand and pushed Swearingen inside and ran away. And Swearingen, interestingly, over the course of the years, has always gotten his prostitutes from orphanages. And more particularly, he becomes convinced that night, his first night in the orphanage, that his mother, who is now on the ship to go to the Georgia mines, has changed her mind and wants him to come join her. The man who runs the orphanage is holds him back and won't let him get run for the ship. And as the story develops, it becomes clear that what has cost Swearingen his masculinity is not the fact that his finger had been chopped off, but that while he was being held, but that while his finger was being chopped off, Hearst's henchman was holding him back the way he had been held back when he was trying to get to his mother. And he was regressing to a pre-sexual state in the aftermath of having had the finger chopped off. Now, when I began to write the conversation between Swearingen and the prostitute, the only thing I had, and I, more days than not, we show up on the set with nothing to shoot. And I write, you know, or I'll write the day before. And this was a day when we didn't have anything to shoot. And I thought it would be an interesting situation if Swearingen is has become impotent and is blaming the girl. That seems to me to be a situation that everybody can relate to, especially males. But as the scene goes on, the scene kept turning and turning and turning, and finally, as he realizes that it isn't the Freudian, I mean, he didn't understand it was a Freudian explanation, but that he said, it's that fella holding me back that's been getting me down. And he looks at the girl, and he says, that's what I do to you, isn't it? And she says, you never do. Which is a lie, but it's a lie that she believes. And Swearingen says to her, well, bless you for a finger. And the lies that are agreed upon, that reality is a lie agreed upon, is kind of the way we get through each day, and it's also the way we get our scenes done. If we pray hard enough, and we keep showing up.
Do you ever, in a situation like that, rely on the actors to improvise at all?
Excuse me?
Do you rely on...
I'm sorry. Did I step on a line? Do I ever rely on what?
The actors to improvise.
Oh, sure.
And the next question is...
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah?
Absolutely. And the fun of it is to be on the set. And you know, the actors, some of the actors are resentful, and I understand that perfectly. But you know, I believe that fundamentally there are only two motivations, that there's only fear and faith. And fear has 1,000 manifestations. You know, it can be perfectionism, it can be resentment, it can be, but it's all fundamentally fear. And the alternative to all of those possibilities is to act in faith and say, well, I may not be able to do it, but let's give it a shot. And people are so happy when they act in faith. Even and especially as they overcome fear. And I've seen so many actors experience the most profound kind of joy as they discover that all of the rules that they have insisted upon for so long need not necessarily apply. Now, that's not to say that
it would be unfair and a perversity on my part to have a scene ready and not to give it to the actor. And you know, at the beginning of the season, you've got more prepared than you have at the end of the season. And you try to come with a full heart and in full emotional disclosure. And I believe that we are parts of a larger spirit. St. Paul said that, and we don't know each other in our seeming separateness. As St. Paul said, if the hand shall say, because I am not the foot, I am not therefore a member of the body of Christ, is it not of the body? Or does it simply not understand its nature? And in the same way, you know, when someone says, this is my forefinger, oh, he's a wily one. He has a will of his own. And sometimes his buddy jumps in. Yeah. Well, I'm capitalizing on what is obviously fiction, that the members of my hand are part of a larger body. And I believe that when episodes work and when series work, it's because people experience the seemingly separate characters as, in fact, members of a single larger body. And they look forward to being a member of that larger body once a week. And that's why it's a great pleasure for people to have series to come to.
So, essentially, I guess you're talking about collaboration, but on a whole other level, in a sense.
Yes, I'm talking about collaboration the way I believe we're children of the Spirit of God.
So, and that's it. Where do you go from there? Because that's pretty amazing. I want to.
Sure, you want to take a break?
Yeah, exactly. That's all. I want to take us into a bit of the realm of the actor,
because
I mean, speaking of collaboration, I mean, you do obviously from a writing perspective, you have a long history of working with Steve Bochco. So I want to know more about that.
Sure.
But I also want to know more about your collaboration with actors. There are some actors that do appear in several of your projects.
Yeah, all the time.
Yeah. So can you talk about that? And what leads you to want to work with an actor over and over again? And what attracts you to specific actors?
Because
in the first
place? They inhabit, they give themselves up, and they inhabit whatever part they come to. And a lot of times they think they don't, you know, but it's in them, and they just can't help it. They're just good no matter what. And then there are some actors in whom fear predominates, with the exception of certain situations or certain moments. And then you try to find for that actor a situation or moment congenial to the circumvention of the fear that liberates them to act in faith.
So are you talking about, like, once they're hired, their fear, let me see if I understand you. So once they're hired, they'll be in the role, and there's something that's stopping them from actually doing the
sure.
performance that you're looking
sure.
for?
Sure, and then you change the part especially if you've worked with an actor before, and so you know it's there, you know, you can always, I'm always, in the same way that I rewrite everything every day, and I'm, if an actor has an idea, you have to be respectful. I mean, it's not a question of respect; it's a joy to be responsive, you know.
So you,
but it has to be responsible. You have to have had the experience of the actor as responsible in saying, you know, that doesn't feel right to me, or I don't think she'd have said that, or and if you know them, you believe them.
So that comes from having worked with them before and knowing.
Or just being in faith yourself, you know, or saying let's take the chance.
So
that's fun.
Can you talk a little bit about the process if you're casting a new show? Luck, I guess, was the most recent. How are you involved in the casting process, and can you share a bit about what your experience is like going through
that? Was very different for me. Typically, I'm involved very much in the casting, but this was, the company was kind of going for the gusto. They wanted, you know, Dustin Hoffman as a lead in this, and Nick Nolte, and a lot of recognizable, Michael Gambon, who's a wonderful British actor. And so I stood back from the casting process in that regard, to my regret in some instances, but, you know, that's just the way things go.
So in more of a typical situation,
the more typical situation, I'm there for everything and for all the parts, and a lot of times you'll see something and you'll change the part, you know, you'll see an actor and you think, I wrote that wrong, you know, that's the guy and I wrote him wrong, and that's fun too. You know, it really does come down to the feeling of when fellow spirits are coming in faith to the process. And if you feel that, you know, you pick it up. It's like playing music. You know, you enjoy improvising and trust in the other musician.
So what tips do you have for actors who are not Nick Nolte and Dustin Hoffman, are not names, you know, that, you know, are out there and they're doing guest star roles and co-star roles, et cetera, to stand out in that way, to bring that forward. And
yeah, I don't have a clue. There's a beautiful poem by Stanley Kunitz that begins, in times like these, the heart breaks and breaks and lives by breaking. And that's the life of an actor. There's nothing for it. There's nothing to be done. Except you must learn to let your heart live by breaking. You have to show up in good spirit. And when you are met by seeming indifference or callousness or worse, you must stay in communion with the spirit. And you'll ask yourself 1,000 times, did I? You know, was there something that I did or should have done? I have acted a lot of times, you know, to get out of jail. But
you were on L.A. Law, though, weren't you?
Pardon?
You had some roles on L.A. Law?
Yes, I've been in a few things. But none as serious as the roles I was playing in Louisiana, for example. but you ask yourself, have I come in faith? And you just ask to be willing. And the thing is, the willingness is its own reward, and you have to accept that. And it's very, very, it's hard, it's so hard, because one is so tempted to accept resentment as an organizing principle, and it fits all the time, and you can't let it, because then you're licked. then you aren't coming in willingness, then you don't deserve the next shot. But I have often said that I just couldn't do it. I couldn't do it. And so what occurs to me is I encourage people to be working all the time to be to create their own roles. And there's an enormous dignity that comes from being in a room and taking a scene and playing it. And it seems so futile, and invariably you will walk out uplifted.
It goes back to what you're talking about between faith and fear, and that if we as actors can operate from a point of faith, and for you it was a process over time to get to that point as a writer, and
sure.
You involve prayer and some a ritual to that, that we need to develop our own so that we can access our own authenticity and passion and get out of our own way.
The paradox is that self-empowerment entails ultimately the negation of the self. And that's tricky business, you know, to ask to be released from the bondage of self in order to carry yourself in faith. And the only thing that I do is I try to be open. I try to be accessible. You know, I try whenever I meet somebody to be present. And that's not bad advice for you. Try always to believe the best of the other person, and get ready to get your teeth kicked down your throat, and keep coming back.
So given the way that you approach your writing and your career and your philosophy of your artistry, how do you deal with the hardcore realities of the business? Product placement and pitching your shows and getting and just navigating the whole the business. I mean, at this point in your career, I think, you know, obviously you have your track record, but that when you were starting, that wasn't the case. How do you navigate it?
It's almost absurd to talk about now, you know, because the real exigencies of the artist situation have to do with finance, and I'm not broke, so for me to say this or that about try to have a smile on your face but in the deepest sense it's true. Because otherwise you're already beaten, you know. But what I can speak to at this point in my career is when those with whom I collaborate, I believe, are not acting in faith. When they say the audience is stupid, the audience they need this, they need this. And if it's at the expense of the credibility of the situation or of the behavior of the actor, I won't do it. And there have been situations, recently where that sort of thing goes on. And that's where someone in my position who is not compelled by financial considerations, but is trying to be truthful and faithful to the work, that's when you gotta stand up. Did you ever see the movie Tootsie?
Yes.
Isn't that a wonderful scene where Dustin Hoffman is talking about being faithful to being a tomato?
Yes.
When the director was trying to tell him to do something, and he says, a tomato wouldn't do that. There's a deep truth in that.
You've been collaborating.
Let
with...
Let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
What time is it, sir?
It's just after, it's 20 after 7 almost.
And how long are we going to go?
About 11, 12. No, I'm kidding. we're going to 8, okay. And we're going to stop and get some, we're going to do some questions.
Can we take 5 minutes now?
Yeah.
Is that okay? And then reconvene?
Yes, we're going to break for 5 minutes. Don't go anywhere. So please don't, just hang tight. Please don't leave the room. People online, don't go anywhere. If you have any more questions, this is the time to bring them up on cards. Oh, thanks. Thank you. Okay. Everybody, take a seat if you're not already seated. So we're going to go to some questions. This is live streaming across on the web across the country. Isn't that cool? The world. No, it's actually just the U.S. And so people are emailing questions in. So we're going to start with one of those, and then we'll keep going. So with regards to your police projects, how much of those are directly related to real events? This is from Lillian Richardson. She doesn't say where she's from, but she's online. Do you actually do research? I know that Bill Clark was one of your inspirations,
yes,
right?
That's right. And continues to be, and he's a good friend. Anything that I'm doing, I try to kind of live into the world that it's based on. In the instance of horse racing, which is the most recent project, I had a pretty good leg up being a degenerate gambler for 40 years, so I didn't have to do too much research.
Well, you're into horse racing. I mean, you own thoroughbreds, don't you?
I own horses, virtually every mistake that can be made around a horse, I have made. Short of any sexuals.
That's the next project.
You know that I owned a horse that was running in the Breeders' Cup, which is a $1 million race, and a woman tried to have relations with this horse the night before, and offered $50,000 to the groom in whose care the horse was. Imagine. Or don't, as you may prefer.
There's no segue from that one.
No.
I'm trying to find one, but I can't. So what's next for you? I mean, that would be a good ending question, but I'm going to ask it now, just because.
Well, as I say, I'm doing a film for Warner Brothers, and then there is talk, and it's no more than talk at the moment, but it seems to be pretty serious talk about doing two-hour Deadwoods, that would please me mightily, for a series of circumstances that aren't really worth going into. I don't think that got the finish that I had hoped for. So maybe that will be coming up. And there are always a whole slew of possibilities, one of which involves the adaptation of several of William Faulkner's works, which would be something that would be a great privilege for me.
Preston, who's here, wants to know if you'd consider doing Illusions by Richard Bach.
I don't know it.
Illusions. Any reasons why you brought that up?
It basically is so in line with what you were saying specifically about
really?
The symbol, how the agreements.
I'll get it.
Absolutely.
I'll get it. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. I'm stalling.
He wrote something. Yeah, that's
yes. There was this great question in here, and I'm trying to find it, which was, where is it?
It's okay.
Oh, here it is. I found it. This is hilarious. Did you pattern your character Con Stapleton after your life? And the question is from Peter Jason. Who played Con? Where is he? There he is.
Hello, Peter, my wonderful Peter. Hello, how are you, Jerry? Those are two wonderful, wonderful actors, both of whom were on Deadwood.
Yeah.
Peter Jason and Jerry Jewell. Jerry, thank you for your book. It was wonderful. Jerry just published her autobiography. And the answer is yes, totally.
Did you ever get to see yourself in John from Cincinnati?
I loved it.
I loved it.
I never knew what I was doing, but I loved doing it.
Peter played God as the owner of a used car lot.
So this is from Nick Bennett. From Nick Bennett, as an actor, writer, currently selling a TV show. Nick, are you here? Nick Bennett? Yeah. Oh, there he is.
Nick?
He's got his hand up. Okay.
There you are.
Looking back, what in hindsight was the biggest thing you wish you knew when selling or creating or producing your first show?
Geez, there's so much I was glad I didn't know. I think of life and I think of our work, you know, as an unfolding adventure. The idea of having an advantage that if, you know, had I known more, I could have done something. I wish that I had been a more fully achieved spirit. I wish that I had had a more continuous, uninterrupted access to my gift. But I try not to regret too much. Or where would you stop?
This is from one of our people out in the live webcast world. Michael Zaks asks, how do you look at supporting characters in your scripts? How important are they in the overall story other than a glance away from the main story and the main characters?
Oh, no, every character, and Jerry and Peter can both testify to the truth of this. They're all waiting to be main characters, and there have been so many wonderful scenes that both Peter and Jerry did, and they would have been considered supporting character. Jerry played the maid in the whorehouse, and she had a walking impediment, and we did a storyline at the end of the first season where the doctor, who's very sour on humanity, brings himself to make a boot to help her walk, despite the fact that she has these other impedimenta, which seems to make it a futile exercise. And she and the doc wind up dancing pretty good.
So we've touched on this a bit. Brenna Weiss, are you here?
I'm here. Hi.
Hi, Brenna.
Hello, Brenna. Hello, how are you?
I mean, Brenna asks about, you know, your interest in making films. I mean, you are making a film now, but mm-hmm. your career is pretty much specifically focused
yeah.
on television.
The writer is such a disempowered figure in filmmaking. It doesn't have a whole lot of interest for me. I have fixed, I don't know, 20 movies, but I never, look for credit. I as a degenerate gambler, you know, you're always looking for something in a brown paper bag, See, I remember, actually, this horse that the lady wanted to fornicate with was running down in Florida in this million-dollar race, and as a certified sociopath, you know, I had invited about 150 people down there for the race, and my business manager says, you know, this very generous, very open-hearted of you, but you have enough money to pay to get him down there, but if the horse loses, they're stranded. So I told my agent to get me something, a film to fix. And it turned out to be Bad Boys. So I'm working on this thing, and the guy who was producing it had a few issues, and he would call me up and berate me and say, "Who did you say you worked for? The Munsters?" I was taking his abuse, and my horse won. $1 million. So, I turned the script in, and on the basis of the pages, the script got greenlit. You know, they're going to go ahead and make it. So now they want me to finish it, because they had just asked me to do the first 50 pages in order to get the green light. So I said, "Yeah, you got a good case. I'm about to go back to work for this psychopath." So they say, I remember at a certain point the negotiations got to, what if so-and-so agrees to go into rehab? So I said, "Get back to me when so-and-so agrees to get hit by a bus." which was not very kind of me. But the thing is that I remember this, in fact, this producer saying, "I think that I owe it to a film to have at least a dozen writers." And, you know, but that kind of assembly line mentality is oftentimes, because filmmaking is so fear-based, and you get that kind of sensibility, and it's something that I don't respond well to. Yeah.
And the next question. This one doesn't have a name, but the question is essentially, you have a production company. If someone has an idea for a show, do you take pitches or do you take...
Sure. That's a tricky business. Because ours is regrettably, you know, a very litigious kind of culture, I pretty much wind up doing my own work just because it's very idiosyncratic. You know, it's how could you tell? I try to avoid taking pitches, but I don't at all try to avoid, and in fact, always eager and happy to meet people. I think that there are certain rooms where they talk about the brotherhood of the spirit, and I'm very glad to feel that. And so, if anybody wants to call or anything, please feel free.
Uh oh. You're going to get a lot of calls.
That's okay.
Okay. So describe a typical, this is from Colleen, and is it Brat?
Bra.
B-R-A-H. So Colleen and Bra. Oh, Colleen and Bra, like Anne's a name.
Exactly.
I thought there's two of you. Okay. Describe a typical pitch meeting for us on one of your shows that were made. So does 5 minutes turn into 2 hours? Do you stick with your original idea? Do you have marketing ideas in your back pocket? What typical pitch?
No, I don't do any of that. The paradox is that the more progress you make in the business, the less there is to the pitch. As we remarked earlier, there have been times when I would go in and think I was going to talk about one thing and wind up talking about something else. But you try and get to a point where you trust the people that you're in the room with, and the more you know each other, the more you're willing to rely on that knowledge as opposed to the particular idea. Does that make sense?
Yeah, for a new person that's
That's a tough one.
A new person.
You should write. I wouldn't pitch. You should write a pilot because it's the execution of the idea much more than the idea itself, which is crucial. And what you need to do is be able to demonstrate the capacity to execute.
I have that.
You got it then.
I have it. Yeah, I have the script.
There you go.
I'm this close to my pitch meeting.
You're this close to your meeting?
This close to my pitch.
Well, good luck.
Well, you have an ongoing collaborative relationship with HBO.
Yeah.
Correct. So can you tell us a little bit of what that's like? You have certain relationships there, and you just kind of ongoing.
Yeah, but it isn't exclusive. You're exclusive for a period of time. But one also maintains relationships with the creative community, and I try to you always have plenty of ideas, and nothing makes you happier than to give them away, so I'm always talking with other writers, and there's a lot of writers in the building, it isn't as isolated and restrictive an environment as you might imagine, because it's so deeply and profoundly the case that it's not the idea so much as the bringing of it to life, and that has more to do with the creative sensibility that's generating it rather than the idea itself.
It's so where you can go with the idea that's more important.
Yeah, and try always to lead with your chin. Always try to trust. Don't be afraid that someone's gonna steal your idea. To do the as much as possible. Do the idea yourself, and because it's that when I went in, the first thing that I ever wrote for television, I had been a school teacher, and. When I went in, I didn't have the vaguest idea what a pitch was, and I was hired to write a script, and I had never seen a script, and so I stole a script, and I wrote. When I wrote the script, I figured everything out except I couldn't figure out what int and ext meant. So I went according to the numerical pattern. You start with one ext, then you have two ints, another ext, four ints, and I did my whole script that way. And so I turned the script in, and they bought this. They said, "This is terrific, but what, you've got inside scenes outside and outside scenes." I says, "Look, if you can't take a joke at this point,
this is from this is a Twitter at Bupitiba.
At where?
I don't know. I don't get Twitter, but it's just at something. I don't know.
B-O-O. I can't imagine what that world is like.
I don't Twitter, but I do use a computer.
You do?
Yeah, I do.
Yeah.
It's just,
God
know.
Bless you.
Thank you. What's the craziest thing an actor's done to try and get a role on any of your projects? This isn't encouragement, right?
Yeah. A lot of times actors come in costume, it works if you're a good actor.
Wow, that was so diplomatic. That's great.
I remember the actress who, wonderful actress who played Calamity Jane, came in full Jane drag.
Molly Parker? No, that
no,
was someone
no,
else.
No,
sorry.
But Robin Wiegert, and she was just great. And then another quite prominent actor came in full Wild Bill Hickok drag, and I hated him with a mortal passion. Oh, it just shows you.
So just come in with like a hint maybe of like the period might be good, right? There's some of these questions we've really covered, so I just want to try and see if there's anything new. Someone wants to know how they'd go about interning for you.
That's, you know, a very, God only knows how that happens. At the right moment, if somebody asks you, you know, you hire them. I mean, but feel free to write a letter and.
Okay. How are you doing? You're like okay to few go for a few more minutes? Or?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Sure.
How much? This is from Matt. Matt.
Yeah.
Hey, Matt. How much research did you do for Deadwood before writing the pilot?
Oh, before writing the pilot, I did a lot. I went and lived up there for a while and with a bunch of rodeo cowboys. It was like a plague of locusts descending, and 6 months easy of research.
Wow. And I guess because reading all the diaries and doing all the historical research, that was part of that 6 months?
Yeah, the Library of Congress and a lot of secondary materials. And in particular, I was interested in the patterns of speech and the distinction between people who had what was called book learning and people who didn't. You know, the people who had book learning tended to speak in an almost Elizabethan way, and trying to get those rhythms right and stuff was a challenge, but it was one I very much enjoyed.
So did you have someone like a dialect consultant or something like that?
Afterwards, not before, but once the show was cast, we had dialect coaches and stuff.
Hmm. So at what point, because of your process that you've already described about that's very, very free in your writing, at what point did you let go of all that research and just, or did you always refer back to it?
No, once I was done with it, I was done with it.
And so you didn't really consult it after that? Wow. Okay. How would you characterize your creative relationship with Dusty? This is from Stephen Knight?
Yeah.
With Dustin Hoffman.
It says Dusty.
It was a pleasure. Dustin is a real athlete. He brings it every day, and he is fierce in his discipline and commitment to the work. At the same time, you know, he's full of fun, but don't get between him and his art. You know, he's great. He's great. Great, great actor.
The prayer that you mentioned, Edith Davis in L.A., who's online, wants to know how you can find, where she can find the prayer that you quoted.
That's the third step prayer in the 12 steps of Alcoholics Anonymous.
So was AA an influence on you?
Well, if it were, I wouldn't be supposed to talk about it too much.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, so I think you can infer from.
You can infer. I guess kind of extrapolating from a question is where you found your, how you developed your spiritual sense. What event or if any event?
Yeah, I think life is an accumulation of spiritual events, and the blessing is to be able to recognize them.
Staying open is what you're saying. Okay. Can you define, this is Sarah Solis. Sarah's behind the camera.
Yes.
Hello.
I mean, this is, you've kind of talked about this, but is there a way that, do you define, I'm going to translate this. I mean, you're asking, can you define what an artist's voice is? But I think you've shown us what that is.
Well, thank you. I think that the artist's voices are the spirits that inhabit him or her. The artist's voice is the voice of form, and that's the trickiest one because it's we associate it with the boss, and to have a descriptive voice which is able to submit itself to the organization and description of a scene without becoming formalist or rigid is a great gift to a script. But it isn't often that the ability to project yourself into so many different voices coincides with an ability to have that sort of formal voice. And they're different. They're different. And don't worry if you don't have the formal voice. Just write X, 1X, 2 inch.
Danielle is at the back. So Danielle was an exercise writer at Santa Anita.
No kidding.
A writer in your show, Luck.
Where are you? Hi, Danielle. I can't see you.
So Danielle wants to know.
Thank you for your work.
In the series, does the writing focus more on character, or with the involvement of Michael Mann, does it seem to lean toward more action sequences involving the racing? How do you feel about the direction?
Yeah, that's something that shifts sort of day to day and depending on what you're doing. I think that Michael brought a very, Michael Mann, who's a director and the executive producer with me on the show, brought a real muscularity of visual perspective. And I'm sure you can testify, the racing is very, very realistic and very compelling. Is that adequately diplomatic?
And we've asked these have been answered. Well, this is kind of a good question. I mean, you talked about it in terms of improvisation. This is from Monique Carmona. Monique? Hey, Monique.
Hi, how are you? Good to see you.
So Monique asks, how does acting inform writing and vice versa in the process of storytelling? And I just want to say that, I mean, essentially, it's so apparent that you're a storyteller at your heart. You're just an incredible gift that you've given us through your stories. What is the relationship, or is it the similarity between your process and what you see as an actor's process?
The great actors are all storytellers, and their particular gift, their entire being is their instrument. And there is, it's indistinguishable the way an actor moves, the way he blinks, it's all a unity and a presence, and as a writer, you feel like you're stealing. Because you just get shivers because the artist is so present, he or she so embodies not only the character but the moment, and it's very, very exciting, and that's why being on the set for the moment of art
is kind of a religious experience. Just great. How about if we leave it there?
Let's leave it at that. Thank you so much, David Milch.